guys, today I wanted to discuss the top 10 things to do before buying a house. These things are all important, and there's only one that I suggest really doing in order. Everything else you can kind of do out of order, whatever is most convenient for you. So let's get started. The first step is actually, I know I'm a little biased, but it's to hire a realtor. And this needs to be someone that you fully trust, someone you feel extremely comfortable with, and someone that you feel like you can go to for anything. So a realtor can actually save you time and money in the long run, which sounds kind of crazy, but it's true. So a realtor is going to know the areas that you are wanting to look into and might know areas that you might not even know about, and be able to broaden your horizons a little bit. A realtor is also gonna have the appropriate negotiation skills and the know-hows in order to get you a better deal as well as protect you during the transaction. The second thing I definitely suggest doing is researching schools, drive times, and traffic patterns. This is one of the most looked over steps when looking for a house. So researching schools is actually a little easier than what you would think. So a great resource I refer my clients to is called greatschools.org, and this website has the school ratings as well as information on different schools and where they're located. And I definitely suggest looking in the different school boundaries as well, because those do change over time and sometimes yearly, especially when there's a lot of new builds going on. And between the San Antonio and New Braunfels area, there's a ton of new construction and school zones are changing. So I definitely suggest that. Another thing, of course, to do is looking at drive times and traffic patterns. So if there's a certain neighborhood that you're interested in looking at, I definitely suggest going there during the busy, crazy time of 7 in the morning, 5 p.m., and looking at what that traffic pattern looks like, what your flow looks like, maybe even using the Waze app and being able to see what your drive time could be. Another great thing to look at also is maybe there's a couple of back roads you can take, and that can definitely save you time and get you to your family quicker. The third step is to get pre-qualified with a mortgage lender. And this is a non-negotiable when you're actually ready to be house hunting. So in our market, it's extremely competitive, and most sellers actually don't even allow buyers to come into their house without having a pre-qualification letter. When you're working with a realtor, they're definitely gonna ask you to have a pre-qual letter, and this is gonna save you a lot of headaches and some unnecessary stress as well. So a mortgage lender is gonna be able to tell you what your purchasing power is up front, as well as let you know estimated costs on down payment and closing costs. This is something that I definitely suggest my clients doing and knowing ahead of time as well, beyond just unnecessary stress. This helps me to negotiate if my clients are also needing any kind of closing cost assistance as well. The fourth step is actually pretty fun. It's writing out a list of what your wants and your needs are, because those are two different things. So I definitely suggest writing out your own list and then having your partner write out their list, and then y'all come together and meet up and go over your list together before you meet with your realtor. So this is gonna save you a lot of those unknown wants and needs that maybe your partner has or that you have, and it gets you on the same page, and it's definitely going to help you before you go out house hunting to be able to hone in on what kind of house you're looking for and the items that are necessities and things that are kind of bonuses. So the fifth step is actually kind of right before you get into house hunting. I definitely tell my clients to keep an open mind when we're house hunting. So I give them a list and they'll go through houses and they'll tell me which ones they want to go look at. And then sometimes I throw in some houses that, depending on what their wants and needs are when we go over that, depending on what they're looking for, I might know of a house that's in a different neighborhood or a different school district or area that they might be interested in. And sometimes my clients do end up going with these houses. And some of these houses might need a couple of upgrades done to them. And if the value is there and if it fits what my clients are looking for, it's kind of a surprise and they end up going for that house too. So definitely keep an open mind and trust your realtor. The sixth step is actually something I suggest before after, during the entire home buying process, and I'm calling it trust your instincts. So one of the biggest things that I see with my clients is when we're house hunting, they might be interested in a house and they're kind of sitting on the fence about it, or they want to take a day or two to think about it, which totally fine. I never want to pressure my clients into anything because this is such a big investment for them. However, our market is so competitive, and sometimes in a certain price point, if they wait even a day or even sometimes an hour, they could get into what's called a multiple offer situation and have a multiple bidding kind of war going on with the house. I really try to keep my clients out of a situation like that as best I can. So if you're really feeling a house and if for some reason you're kind of like, ugh, I really want to think about it, or I'm just afraid to pull the trigger, don't worry. There's something called an option period that you can back out. I like to call that a cold feet period as well. I can go over this in another video, but just know that there are options to getting out of a contract in the beginning phases, and sometimes it is best just to pull the trigger and go for it. Okay, so the seventh step is kind of like a on your own step. It's more of a piece of advice. So I'm calling this one new construction pitfalls. So with all of the new construction in my area, in San Antonio, New Braunfels, it is just growing and exploding like crazy. So for my clients to get a new construction home and be able to afford that, it's becoming more and more tangible. They're making so many houses out here. There's lots of sales going on and there's a lot of inventory. So it's great. The biggest mistake I see my clients and other people make is that they think they're gonna save their realtor time by going and visiting these model homes and seeing if they like the houses or not. And as sweet and loving and wonderful as that is, a lot of builders will not allow your realtor to represent you in a contract if they're not with you the first time you go to a model home. It sounds crazy, but they will not recognize that realtor. And so whenever you go to a model home, the sales representative at the front will ask you to register with them. And even if you write down your realtor's name on the card, a lot of the times if that realtor is not present with you, they will not recognize your realtor. Even if you have a private contract with them called a buyer's representation agreement, sometimes they will not recognize that. I definitely suggest letting your realtor know if you're gonna go and visit these model homes, and don't think of it as wasting their time because it's actually kind of fun. I think it's fun anyways, going and looking at houses. I know, crazy. Another pitfall that I'm gonna associate with new construction especially is if you're thinking that you don't need a realtor to buy a new home, technically you don't. However, I'll let this one sink in. The sales representative at the front office or model home actually works for the builder. They don't work for you. So they are getting paid by the builder. So whatever the builder wants, that's what the builder gets. So a realtor can actually negotiate terms that you might not even know about, and the sales representative won't negotiate those for you. And so they pretty much, I mean, there's some really cool ones out there. Not gonna lie, some of them are really nice. But it doesn't come down to nice. It comes down to business. And they won't have your best interests at heart, unfortunately. Okay, the seventh step would be discussing what your upfront costs are with your realtor. So anytime I meet with a new client, I go over their wants and needs list, and I definitely discuss what upfront costs are. Now, a lot of these costs are negotiable items, which is great because you kind of get to decide between yourself and the seller what those prices are. But knowing that you're gonna have upfront costs and kind of a ballpark of what those could be will definitely save you from some unnecessary stress and be able to get you on the right track for saving up as well. The ninth step is to start saving for a down payment now. Whether you're looking to move and buy a house a year from now, 2 years from now, or even 6 months from now, start saving now. This is going to help you in the long run because this might even help you increase your purchasing power, which means the price that a lender will lend up to. So that will help you, as well as to help you from some unnecessary stress along the way too. The 10th and final step, definitely if you are worried about credit, debt, or your financials in general, I definitely suggest speaking to a mortgage lender now. Even if you're a year or plus out from doing that, it's free to talk to a lender and to go over this information. Now, I know a lot of people will have some reservations about providing your financial information. A lender does hold on to your file, and so if you decide that you're not going to be ready for another year or two, you can let that lender know. And actually, in my experience, I found out that a lot of people, when I have them discuss their finances with a lender, they find out that they're actually ready to buy a house now and they didn't realize it. So that could be your case as well. And the good thing about that too, and speaking with a lender up front, is sometimes there are down payment assistance programs. Sometimes if you're a little worried about your credit, there's programs that they can refer you to help you with that as well. And a lot of the times, I have lenders help my clients be put on a plan. And so a lender will tell you, okay, in the next, you know, year, if you pay this off, if you pay that off, and if you reduce your debt by this much, then your purchasing power will increase and you'll be ready to buy. So they do give you a little plan to go along within that year instead of kind of just making it up on your own. So I definitely suggest getting this done. That way you know where you stand today and what you need to work on for the next year. I hope you guys enjoy these 10 tips on what to do before buying a house. And if you guys have any questions, don't hesitate to reach out. I hope you guys have a great rest of your day.